good morning to all of you. Today we have Dr. Anjali Agarwal with us. She is a renowned consultant, physiotherapist and lifestyle consultant and childbirth educator. She is a certified lifestyle counselor and covers an array of issues relating to dietary and nutrition advice and psychological counseling, stress management and exercise prescription. She's educated from the prestigious IPGMER SSKM Hospitals, Kolkata, and has done specialist training with the NHS UK London. She runs a program, Restore Your Core, along with Fit Mum prenatal and postnatal exercise classes. She's also the brand ambassador for Physical Literacy Days, run by Pulela Gopichand Academy. She's been awarded as Best Physiotherapist by Remedy Systems and Services Chennai and a pioneer in birth by the Humanity International Conference on Women Health at Bangalore in 2018. She's also been awarded for being a role model for setting Accessible India campaign in Hyderabad. So this was a brief introduction of our guest today. And the topic that we would be discussing about is early intervention for delayed milestones, referring to difficulty in breastfeeding and torticollis or flathead syndromes. So Dr. Anjali, very warm welcome to this session and thanks for joining us. I'm leaving it up to you to drive this webinar now with your presentation, and later on we will take up questions directly from the attendees so you can answer them.
Thank you, Priya. Thanks, Moms Believe, for giving me this very broad platform to address the issue related to delayed milestones in early intervention. Hi, everybody. Hi, moms and everybody listening to this talk. Something which is very close to our heart is when we see an infant develop in a very beautiful child and a child developing into a teenager and an adult. So as we say, man has the seven stages of life, and infancy is something which we have to let a child blossom, being able to have all his milestone achieved in a very moderate form of way. For everybody's moderate milestone is different. So today, Dr. Anjali, myself, I'll be touching on different points of what is something called as delayed milestone, referring to the torticollis, which is termed as shortening of your neck, one side of your neck, and especially for the infant. And then going forward, what are the challenges these kids face over the months of development having this kind of a disorder, which can be congenital. It can be something which has happened during the birth in the uterine of the mother, or it's happening the way the mother is holding the baby or placing the baby once the baby is born on the bed or on the crib or while holding the baby on her lap or while breastfeeding the baby. Things which are in your hand or in your favor is if we early detect these issues, we'll be able to address this issue in a much, much earlier way. So I'll be sharing you a brief point as to what all you will look into a child, whether these issues are happening in them, what can be done for them in a brief period of time. Right. So thank you, Priya. You've already introduced me. That's my brief introduction. And my contacts too, if people want to reach out to me with my phone number and my email ID too. So going forward, today's very beautiful topic is torticollis and breastfeeding. Torticollis means you have a kind of a muscle which starts from underneath your ear, goes and attaches to your collarbone. That is called as this sternocleroid muscle. Everybody of you, if you can see me, can touch your muscle there. You feel a cord-like structure. All of you are able to see me? Right? Everybody is able to see me?
Yes, ma'am.
No,
yes.
Ma'am.
We can see the
presentation. No, ma'am. No, ma'am. We can't see you.
We can see the presentation, ma'am.
Right.
Ma'am, I'm sending a request. Please.
You have to start my video, actually.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, the permission is.
So please put it on.
Now, can you see me, right?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Please
yes, ma'am. Now we can see you.
Right. Okay. Fine. Right. So you saw this muscle here, which is called from the ear to your collarbone, right? And this is called as a sternocleroid muscle, which is a muscle where responsible for turning your neck, for bending your neck, for laughing, for yawning, for even opening your mouth. This is the basic function of this muscle. If you see a child who's crying, this muscle gets tight and spasmodic. If you see a child laughing, this is the muscle which is like quite active and quite palpable in nature. So this is what you see in this child here. If you see the child here, right here, you know, this part where I see the muscle here, the ear to the collarbone, this muscle gets shortened in most of these kids. And you see the top surface of the head gets flattened. And these are all in the 21st century or the millennium people I'm seeing is more lot of this deformity is seeing in the small babies, because mothers are not having time to see how the kids are lying. Most of this child are being having shared control of care by nannies or grandmothers, or being looked after by friends. Mothers are working online or have been working for long hours. Parental support, father support, mother support, grandparent support in changing a position of the child appropriately on the bed doesn't happen. And this is what we see in the coming months as the child develops, which is acquired torticollis. Acquired means the baby was formed very nicely in the uterine. Baby came out of the mother's uterus in a very optimal position of the head and the neck. But going forward, as you held the baby, as you made the baby lie down, these kind of issues cropped up. Because as we say, the child's body is just like an earthen clay pot. Whatever shape you give to the baby, that is what the neck or the spine would form. Now going forward, what are the key things you'll notice here? When you hold the child in your arms, the child's neck would just droop off, would just fall off. And the clinical signs which we see as physiotherapists, the mother would always say, my child is not feeding well. The child is cranky. The child is crying, doctor. The child is happy to feed on one side of the breast, but when I bring him or her on the other side of the breast, the baby cries or repulses the breast and wants to run, not just have a breastfeed. Now, if the child is not breastfeeding adequately, that is the challenges which most of these child will grow into being very fussy kids when it's not having his hunger pangs being satiated. So mostly these child would be happy to be fed by a bottle, because you don't have to turn the neck to either side to feed the baby or latch the baby onto the breast. So you will see this demarcation of the baby when the baby is not able to feed on one side of the breast. Baby is not able to turn on one side or is having an eyesight which is quite focused on one side of the room. So if he's looking on the left side, he's continuously looking on the left side. The moment you try to turn the neck on the other side or maybe the right side, they will have a repulsion or they would try to cry because the neck is shortened. Imagine all of you have a shortened neck. There are times when you have a neck spasm, right? When you are working online for long hours, or if you're sleeping in the wrong posture, if you're picked up a long, heavy basket, your neck gets painful. And imagine in that position, if somebody tries to move your neck, you get pain. Similarly, this is what is happening in a small kid. The kid can't tell you anything. It's not very expressive. But these things are very visible when you get to a physiotherapist. And very few of us are very well informed of this condition. So we have to look at all visual cues, what the child is coming to you as. Most of these mothers have come to me for the postpartum checkup. Like they have been with me in the prenatal checkup for their pregnancy care, being their physiotherapist. Now, when they come for my postpartum checkup, they bring the child along with them. And that is when I see the child and I can see that the child is not having the adequate neck posture. His head has got flattened on the side where the child has been made to lie continuously for hours and hours together. That is what leads into a flat head syndrome. The head of the baby should be round and nice and firm. Wherever you touch, you don't feel a flat surface. It's round, like just like a small ball. That is what I say. What you give to your baby now will determine how your baby's posture develops over the years, as a teenager, as adults. All the lifestyle diseases, what we give to your child now is so important, right? Give a nice shape to the baby. The baby's posture is good. Baby's feeding capacity is good. Babies are very happy, a satiated baby. Now, this is what I want to explain you. So in case of here, you see a small child. This child came to me when he was, I'm not showing you the actual pictures of the babies, but just made the cartoon presentation here. The baby's neck has gone to one side. Okay, the normal side, if we look at in the mirror, we have equal size of the length of the neck. But in this case, the baby's neck has shortened. You see the skeletal system? The muscle on one side has become short and taut. So imagine when you open a door which is too tight, like springy, you really need to force your hands onto the door to open the door, right? Suppose you enter a theater or anywhere, there are big, big doors. This is how tight this muscle becomes, very springy in action. Now, if you try to forcefully turn the neck of the baby would cry a lot. And at times when you touch it, you will see a palpable lump-like structure in the neck area, okay? And that is what is the muscle which has gone into spasm. So a baby which is suffering with this is not vocal and is always very fussy and very, you know, because the moment baby lies on the tummy, and when you make the baby do a tummy time around the second month or the third month of this infant, the baby will try to repel because the neck is just turned on to one side. He's not able to breathe. His neck or his nose will touch on the ground and he feels suffocated. So these are the visual signs you will see in your small child. Now, that's what we see, the challenges. That's how mothers will come and say, side-to-side turning is very difficult. So the mother will say, the baby just feeding on one side of my breast, painful sore nipples. As the baby's head is not properly positioned, and we know, in case of breastfeeding, your child needs to have a nice neck control, nice movement of his jaw to open and latch onto your nipple. Now, if the baby is not able to do that, you as a mother would get a lot of painful nipples. The nipples get sore. Many of these women tell us that there's infection in the breast, which is called as mastitis, or painful sore, temperature, red breast. These are all signs that the mother is not able to feed the baby in an optimal position. The baby is not latching well. And then there is repulsion from breastfeeding. So the baby will, at the end of 3 months, 2-4 months, you might have tried all means, help from all your lactation consultants. You might have taken help from all the pediatricians. And then you feel the baby is not able to breastfeed wholesomely. That is the clinical sign that you will actually see a physiotherapist who is dealing with torticollis kids and would help these kids get back to normalcy. So most of the time I'll see, I have had so many kids of torticollis I've been seeing over the years, which is mainly I see in Down syndrome babies or mothers who had painful hips in the pregnancy time. You had pelvic pains and you had pain in your pubic area. You had pain in the tailbone. That means the baby's position in the uterus of the mother was compromised or was not adequate in the uterus. Baby's trying, fighting ways to create space for himself or herself in the uterus of the mother. That is the time when you see most of these babies will come out of the uterus with a neck which is called as congenital torticollis. There's a lot of genetic constitutions causing it. There's a lot of other development factors while the baby was in the mother's uterus, which can be responsible for this. But now I'm touching on the main point where you are in control as a mother. The moment the infant is handed over to you as a small baby, you will have to take care of your positions of breastfeeding, how you're holding the baby, how you're making the baby lie down. How and when your nannies are holding these babies are very important. How and when your grandparents are holding your babies is very important. television, YouTube, phone, gadgets all around the baby, lighting in the room, everything so responsible for having a universal development of the neck, universal development of your sternocleidomastoid joint. So when this baby would have a neck like this, the baby will have issues with his arm. He won't be able to crawl well. He'll have delayed standing posture. So he'll have a lot of issues walking, running and standing if not corrected in time. Because if your neck is like this, the baby's hip positions would change. And most of these babies complain of colic pain, pain in the tummy. And they'll also have pain while passing motion. They'll be constipated. Because if the neck is shortened, this muscle is very much in control of the muscle down around the hip. They're all controlled. The moment you touch this area, the baby's hip muscles relax and the baby's constipation gets better. But if this muscle is contracted, the muscle down there in the hip is also tight. And that is the reason most of these babies will have issues with constipation. Right now, since I'm online and I'm also helping the babies through telehealth appointments, and we can address this issue by teaching the moms online, by helping the babies change the position, helping the baby's colic pain come down, and also help the baby's hip muscles to relax and help with constipation. So the lot of things we can correct for the baby is through online, where the mother is the best physiotherapist. The mother can correct it with her help, with her own hand, with our guidance and with our help through online. So there is always light at the end of the tunnel. So I would say the years your baby spends with you in the first 3-4 months is very important. Watch out for the visual cues. Right. Now, this is what you see. The baby's neck has been shortened. And we teach the mother or the physiotherapist whom where you can take the baby with. We try to rotate the neck. The neck is shortened one side. We try to pull the neck up and then trick it up. This kind of self-stretching exercise is done on a daily basis. And most of these babies in my clinical practice have shown very, very good results in the first 3 weeks of their treatment. So if baby would be very cryful, baby would be very, very depressed when you do this, it will be a very painful session for the baby. But you need to try and coax yourself as a mother or as a parent to help those babies. Or you take them to a qualified physiotherapist who can help these babies get a nice neck stretch. So this is very, very important to do this before any breastfeeding act of yours. If you do that, and if you know when to look for what kind of torticollis this baby is having, whether the left or the right, because it's not just right, it's left and right both. So we will have to accordingly stretch the muscles. So we can see the babies online and we can see which muscle is shortened. Accordingly, online, we help the mother and guide the mother what to do, and the babies are able to get a good stretch and a good neck. So I've had babies, because of confidentiality of those, we're not sharing it here on the online session, but these babies were coming to me for the first 3 to 4 months, and now the baby is happy baby. Baby's trying to walk and run within 1.5 years. And earlier the mother would come as a postpartum mother to me. And then when I saw the baby was very fussy, very cryful, and I said the baby is not feeding well, the mother had sore nipples, that's when we start working on the child. Most of the time, the pediatricians would also miss out on these signs. So it's very important that you visit a qualified pediatric physiotherapist or a women's health physio. They also train into it and we actually help. Now, to prevent this in the prenatal period, that is when you are pregnant as a mother, it's very important you see a physiotherapist who's trained into women's health or a pelvic floor physio, which I usually see women as. We actually settle the pelvis so that baby has very good room of opportunity to grow in the mother's uterus. So the neck grows in all levels and no shortening of the muscle happens. So there's a lot of things which can prevent when the baby's in your uterus. Lot of things you can prevent from happening when the baby's born. And all these things actually lead into delayed milestone. So baby will not be able to crawl well, baby will not be able to sit well because the neck is all crooked. So all these things, if looked at a very early stage, a lot of things can be addressed. Right. Now, this is an alternative position, which I would say for torticollis babies. Now, as you see, the neck of the baby is shortened. If you try to bring, if I have a neck which is right side torticollis, I can usually feed it from the left side of the breast of the mother. But if I want to bring it on the right side, I have to hold the baby in a different breastfeeding position. But this position, which we say baby is sitting on your lap, on your mummy tummy, and the baby's neck is relaxed with your hand, and you can bring the baby's mouth to your nipple. So this kind of position can be usually given for babies with torticollis, and you can reach your goal of breastfeeding the baby with this kind of a deformity. But I would say just do not look at having a secondary option of just feeding the baby the position the baby feels happy with. Work on reducing his torticollis, because you don't want the child to grow up with a neck which is crooked, because lifelong this is what would develop. The first 4 to 6 months is what you develop this kid as, that's when you can treat it better. But if you let it grow, you will have to undergo for a surgical release of this muscle, which most of the pediatric surgeons would do it within the first 2 years of the life. And if it goes beyond 5 years, it's very difficult to control this condition. So earlier, the better. The intervention point of view, we want non-surgical intervention. So this is the way which we look at. Right, mom. So I'll be stop sharing the screen now, and we are open for questions now. Right. Okay, moms. Hello. Right. Hi, moms. So now we are open for questions now. And as I told you, what torticollis is something which we will have to look at in a very detailed way.
Sure, ma'am. Priyadarshini. Hi, Priyadarshini. Priya, hello. Are you able to hear me?
Yep. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
Hello. Can yes, you go ma'am. Ahead with the questions?
Yes, ma'am. Some parents have a question. One is Mohammed Safed. I'm unmuting to Mohammed Safed. So please ask your question.
I think Mr. Shift, yeah, go ahead. Can you
unmute? Ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. Hello?
Yeah.
Can I proceed?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, so 1, 2 and 1/2 year old kid is there. So the kid has a problem with walking. I mean, the kid will walk for 1 mile, and after that one step the kid will take, and after that suddenly the kid will sit. And the kid has having speech difficulties, hearing difficulties.
Okay. And when was this kid starting to walk initially?
Initially was 2.5 year old. And after the 2 years only, the kid has started walking.
2.5 years, the kid has started walking. And does the walk involve toe walking?
No, ma'am, properly. The foot will be like support with the floor or ground.
Mm-hmm. And do you see the kid is also having a protruding belly when the kid is walking? Like the kid walks with the protruded belly forward and tries to walk on the toe and mostly.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So it is looking like the kid is hypotonic. You will have to look at developmental studies of him, and probably his hypotonicity is the responsible reason where the kid cannot walk for long. So develop his core muscles, develop his glutes, the anti-gravity muscles, work on those exercises where the kid can have a balance control, and work on his proprioception and balance too.
Okay, ma'am. And ma'am, one more thing I just want to ask, anyhow, the developmental delays happened, right?
Yeah.
So, like, I have to see all the exercise that which you have told me, like core strengthening, then bridging, everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
And will it be helpful if I put the kid in the Swiss ball?
Yeah, core development happening on the Swiss ball only, right? You can do Swiss ball, you can do a lot of workout. Yeah, you can do a lot of things. Trampoline, walk, jumping on the trampoline. These are called proprioceptions and balance release, which you can do for this child.
And one more thing which you have told, hypertonic, right?
Yeah.
So do I have to do hypotonicity?
You can actually do an assessment of this child. Are you into, are you a parent or a physio or occupational therapist?
Yeah, I'm a physiotherapist.
All right. So look for the signs. How do you test the hypotonicity for the child? How do you do that?
Ashworth scale, we have to see, right?
Yeah, you kind of test the child, whether it's hypotonicity, whether it's spasticity, whether it's there is a child where there's spastic diplegia or cerebral palsy, which has affected the child. Rule out that and then develop your plan of proprioception balance training for this kid.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see a lot of questions popping up.
Yeah, there's one Sarabdeep who has a question and dropped in the comment box also. Shiv, can you unmute this person?
Yes, sure, ma'am. Hmm?
Hello? Hello?
Yes. Hi, Saradeep. Now you are on mute. Please ask your question. Saradeep, are you able to hear me?
Hello.
Yes, Saradeep, please ask your question. I think she's unable to ask it right now. We can take the next question.
Okay, ma'am.
There's Rohan Pandey. Rohan Pandey.
Type the question in the chat box. So please keep it.
Yeah, Anjali. So her question is, what muscles are affected by torticollis? Can torticollis correct itself?
So the muscle is the sternocleroid mastoid. We told you in the picture also, right? The muscle which originates from the base of your earlobe and goes and attaches to your collarbone. In vague terms, we are giving as we have a lot of moms also here. So that is the muscle which gets shortened and tight. Okay. Torticollis, if you do the right positioning, use the right pillow when the baby is born, initially in the next week or two, you can actually help it correct itself in the initial month. But if you've let it be there for quite some time, the muscle will already shorten and get contracted, then it can't be corrected on its own. You will have to use your support as a physio, as an occupational therapist, or as a mom who has learned the technique where baby can be controlled with the neck control.
Okay, so Fatima Shamim also has a question. Shiv, can you unmute her? Fatima Shamim.
Yes, yes, I had unmute.
Fatima, please go ahead and ask your question.
Hello, ma'am. Will the mother having spina bifida occulta affect the baby?
Most of the cases of spina bifida, we've seen that it can be hereditary in nature or congenital nature. So look out for the sign that the baby is also born with that. Generally, we also see in the x-rays of the mother or the MRI of the mother, where if the mother has had it, the baby can also have it. But it's always that if the baby is carried that deformity from you, it can affect, sometimes runs in families too.
I hope, Fatima, the answer has satisfied you and given you what you were asking for. Also, now we can take up the question from Reepa Agarwal. Shiv, can you unmute her? Reepa Agarwal.
Hi, Ripa, please ask your question. You are on mute.
Yeah, hi, Dr. Anjali. It was a very nice session. I just wanted to know your experience in managing congenital torticollis. What's the outcome in your practice?
You see, congenital torticollis, as I said, most of the times these mothers will have issues right from the day one of feeding the baby. And luckily, I think most of the physiotherapists or the pediatricians who deal with these cases are able to address. But as I said, the congenital might have happened because of a deformity, which is genetic constitution. Most of them have been corrected within the first 3 to 4 months of controlling the muscles and rapid physiotherapy and all. But in majority of the cases I've seen, they also need to have the release of the muscle, which if done in the first year of the baby, it's very good results. So Ripa, have you seen a case like that earlier? Hello? Ripa, are you there?
Shiv, can you unmute her again?
Yes, ma'am, I heard mute. Please, Ripa, ask your question.
Yes, so I am a pediatrician. I am not a physiotherapist. So we do see a lot of congenital torticollis. And that's why I wanted to ask you, because we do refer them to the physiotherapist. But sometimes, you know, we have to have a release as you suggested. So if the fibrosis set in, so that's why I wanted to ask you, is there anything which helps, you know, in not going for a surgical intervention?
So as I said, when the baby is born, initially if you detect and we're super fast in their assessment, I think all pediatricians should have an assessment form for torticollis once the baby is born, I would say, to rule out congenital torticollis, because you'll be seeing right at the birth. It's not like something that goes up.
So is it a good idea to refer before 3 weeks, or should it be done after that?
I would say just refer the child before the 3 weeks. And if the mother has also take the history, if the mother is having any history of pelvic pains, or she had history of her spine having a back pain issues during pregnancy. If the women's health physio can see these mothers initially, I think a lot of congenital torticollis can be avoided.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
So Dr. Anjali, there's another question which has a very broader base. I couldn't get the name of the person, but it says, please guide us all to all type of problem that comes to CWS and child, and how we can help him and the parents, especially CP, VI, HI, spina bifida, CTEV and others.
Right. I think the gold standard rule is when the mothers who are pregnant and at the time of their scans, lot of these CTEV and all can be prevented, can be seen in the, you know, the scans. That is the time. I think we can't do much about it, but, you know, it's like a surprise for the mother when the child is born with CTEV or the child is born with spina bifida. But looking at the congenital deformities, we see a lot of the genetic constitution is involved here. So a lot of genetic counseling should happen when the mother and the father is trying to conceive. And that way we can actually stop a lot of congenital deformities from coming. And that doesn't happen in majority of the cases which I've seen. Genetic counseling should be the prime important thing whenever any parent is trying to conceive. That's first. Second thing, if this thing has, the mother's conceived, suppose in case of Down syndrome and all, we have amniocentesis, we have the scan, the trisomy scan and everything possible there. But at times, there are parents who still want to continue with those pregnancies. Initial 1 month and soon as the baby's born, I think every child should be seeing a pediatrician, occupational therapist and a physiotherapist and a special educator. I think work on the child right from the beginning. That's very important. In CTEV also, most of the surgeons, the pediatric surgeons come into being and they do a release surgery. And post that, to develop the child's muscles, important that a physiotherapist and an occupational therapist takes control. I have had adults with CTEV releases and they still walk on toes. So you can understand the muscle or the physio was not given to those muscles. So a lot of these child who grow up into adults have issues with gait, have issues with posture. So I think we as a team, like most of us, like physios, special educators, occupational therapists, and gynecologists and pediatricians, we all should be all together working for the betterment of a healthy child. So we should aim that within 1 year, you want a child who's healthy. And I know the milestones are very subject matter, like it doesn't fit all kind of thing. It's very subjective. But at least we should aim for ruling out these basic deformities to be overruled early and to work on the muscles as soon as possible. Earlier, the better is very important. Thank you.
Okay, so Dr. Anjali, and there's Rohan Pandey. Yes. Pardon? You can continue if you have any answers left.
Yeah, especially in case of cerebral palsy. So I had this small child I saw on telehealth, and the child is 7 years old, still walks on toes, and his hand has gone into spasticity. The parent of the child are still not aware that the child has cerebral palsy. 7 years have gone. The parent of the child is only taking the child to an orthopedician. Perhaps we are missing out on ruling out cerebral palsy. So we sent a child for an MRI, send the child to a pediatric neurologist. The child has a spastic diaplegia. And now at 7 years, if we start cerebral palsy, how many years have we lost? So for every parent here, present here, the first 3 years, any type of infection, if you've had, your child has had, if the mother has had an infection when she was pregnant, when the child is born with a cord around the neck, if the child is having delayed crying, all these are signs that the child might have had a brain area which has got ischemic nature or less oxygen was able to reach, which can lead into cerebral palsy. So all parents should be aware, the first 3 years of your child, be watchful. Watch for any signs. Many parents think that it's okay, my child is walking on toes, right? But you really need to go and see a physiotherapist and an occupational therapist and get to rule out what is happening and what is not right for the child. Thank you.
Okay, so here I would like to take another question from Rohan Pandey. He's been waiting patiently. Shiv, can you unmute Rohan Pandey?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Is he unmuted?
Yes, yes. Rohan, please ask your question.
Hello, good morning, Dr. Anjali. This is Rohan. I'm a clinical psychologist.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, ma'am. I have a question that I have a case in my clinic, 2.5 years, child is suffering with global developmental delay. What are the ways of dealing with that child case? What should I do? I'm a clinical psychologist professional.
How was the child?
2.5 years.
2.5 years. And what is the kind of thing you notice in the child?
Lacking physical movement, like having muscle tones and the child is having most of physical lacking movement. So what should I do?
So have you referred the child to a physiotherapist and occupational therapist?
No, not right now.
Why so? Because if he's having issues which is physical in nature, not able to walk, that itself will cause him a lot of psychological issues, right? The child will not be very active, will not be very social, will detest from going down and playing. So a lot of activities which is involved for development of the child would also get delayed. Do you think the child is autistic in nature?
No, not ma'am. Little bit suffering with cerebral palsy.
Yes. So, but the child is not undergoing physiotherapy?
No, not right now. Their parents are not very much concerned.
Okay, so they need to be educated.
They think the things are they think that the things are going very normal. for there.
I know, Mr. Rohan, like this is the challenge which I see. Most of the parents are in denial. They think it is a taboo subject to talk, that my child is not able to walk well, is not able to talk well. I think as parents, as healthcare providers, our role is to guide the parents and tell them that they need to reach out to adequate people and healthcare professional and get the child feel more happier by getting the therapy done at the right time. Right?
All right.
We have to educate the parent because our goal here is to not delay the early intervention.
So ma'am, when most of the cases come to me like these similar cases, so I have very less to tell them what should they do in the child case dealing with global developmental delay. What should I suggest them?
You should say as a child, you should tell them like this is the month the child should be able to walk or should be able to jog or should be able to playfully. And I know every milestone is different per person to person, per child to child. But you will have to be the, the torch bearer when it involves educating the parent because you're the first person who saw the child, right? The child has not been taken to the pediatrician, has not been taken to the physiotherapist. For a parent to understand that the child is having any kind of physical abnormalities, it's very difficult for them to digest. I'm telling you, the seven-year-old kid, the parent and the father and the mother are cousins, okay? So they already have a congenital deformity coming, right? If you're married between the family members, you will also have a congenital deformity. The dominant gene of both the parent coming and the child. Yet the parents are too shy to go and see a pediatric neurologist because they don't want their child to be termed as cerebral palsy.
All right, thank you.
Our goal is to educate the parents that the earlier we intervene, better is the future of your child.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much for the question, Rohan. So, Dr. Anjali, we have another set of questions. One is from Aishwarya and the other one is from Neelam Thakur. I would request Shiv to unmute Aishwarya. Shiv, can you unmute Aishwarya?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, please.
Aishwarya, please go ahead and ask your question. Aishwarya, are you there?
Hi, Aishwarya, please ask your question. You are on mute now.
Hello?
Aishwarya, please go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, Shiv, hi. Hello.
Hi, Aishwarya.
Go ahead. Yeah, hello, doctor. Good morning. I have my younger son. He's 1 year old, 1 year, 1 month to be precise. And he's still, finding it very difficult to sit by him. If you look at his development, he only rolls over and he tries to come on his knees. He's not able to come on his knees. So then we took him to a neurologist. First, we took him to a pediatrician and then they referred us to a neurologist. And then they told that his muscles are not as strong as they should be to do those, activities. And they said that he may be having hypotonia. So how do we go about with this, doctor? How do we, what all should we do so that he's able to, achieve these milestones, at the earliest?
So we have had a lot of cases during this entire lockdown because the pediatric PT department was also closed for a lot of our hospitals and all. So we have seen a lot of I've seen a lot of child online through telehealth. And through the video calls, and we teach the mothers, and mothers do the things right in front of us. This baby was, had a lung infection around 8 months, okay, and was admitted. So because of that, the baby's milestone got delayed and had hypotonia. And still 1.5 years, she's unable to walk. That's when the parent and the mother approached me, and we did an online therapy at least for like 3 weeks continuously. And we see a profound change. Uh-huh. The baby is now walking and running within 2 months. So a lot of things we have done online.
Talking about the surgeries, Dr. Yeah, to mention, he also had a surgery. He had undescended testis. So he had to undergo a surgery when he was 9 months old. So we actually even had that thought in our mind. He would a surgery impact baby's milestones?
See, I just told you this baby at 8 months had a lung infection. Okay. And that affected her milestone. So anything in the body where the baby's natural hormones or everything is getting affected also will have a traumatized effect on the baby too, right?
Right.
So if you work on, the baby's developmental goals and just work on the basic levels of being able to sit, able to crawl, able to get those muscles which are not working right now to work, the baby will be able to be fine. So nothing to be scared of that something is wrong totally with the baby. Earlier, the better. Start it as soon as possible.
So physiotherapy would help him a lot, and that is the only way forward, right?
Yeah, So nobody referred you yet to physio?
No, we have already started with the physio. So we wanted to know if that is enough, or we should also, give him some kind of a supplements which would help him strengthen his muscles, something like that, along with physiotherapy.
Right. I would have a question for you as a parent, you and your husband. Do you think you guys have something called as like hyperflexibility? Like you guys are very flexible?
Yes, doctor, we are. I mean, how would you judge this hyperflexibility?
Like when we say like, I can do a yoga pose very nicely. I can do a split. I can bring my thumb down and touch the wrist, or I can put my hands back. I'm like super flexible, both of us like that.
Yes. Yeah. You guys, we are good that way. Yes.
All right. Maybe I might have to see you and the child one day. Then I can, term it as what's happening.
Okay.
You can put your video on and show yourself, that would be good too.
Yeah, sure, doctor. Doing it right away.
Aishwarya, please drop in your contact number.
Sure. Yeah,
and you can also take Dr. Anjali's contact.
Yeah, can you see the baby? Are you able to see him?
Yeah, I think there's too much light on the baby, but yeah, that's fine. Actually, we can see you. Yeah. I think drop the number and.
So
baby's 1 year, right?
Sorry.
Baby's 1 year.
Yeah. I am showing the baby. I was talking about him only. He's 1 year, 1 month.
Right. So don't worry. We'll look at it and physiotherapy.
He's still not able to stand or sit. Sorry, doctor, can you repeat?
Don't worry. He's not able to stand. He'll be doing it soon. You're undergoing the physiotherapy. Uh-huh. No, it'll get better for him.
Okay. Great. Thank you then so much, doctor. That was really helpful.
Thanks for the question, Aishwarya. Now we can go to the other person. Neelam Thakur has been waiting to ask this question. Shiv, please unmute Neelam Thakur.
Neelam, please ask your question.
Hello, ma'am. Good morning.
Hi. Morning.
My daughter is suffering from delayed developmental delayed milestones. She is 9 years old. She can't walk, ma'am, and she can't tell us about a toilet, potty.
She's just 9 months old.
9 years, ma'am.
9 years?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And she's not able to walk?
Yes, ma'am. She used to crawl only.
All right. And you've seen a doctor. What is the history of your consultancy with a pediatrician, neurologist, and physio?
Doctor, told us that she is suffering from thyroid. Due to thyroid, her mentally and physically development became slow.
Mm-hmm. And you've not seen a physiotherapist?
Yes, ma'am. We are doing now therapy.
Okay.
Now she is able to stand. Now she can stand with holding something, but she is mm-hmm. not able to walk.
Okay. And how is her speech? How does she talk? She doesn't talk at all.
No, ma'am. She doesn't. Only few words. Mummy, Papa, Didi, Dada, Dadi. Only this much she used to tell.
Any MRI of the brain done?
Yes, ma'am. We have done.
What did it show?
All the things are normal, ma'am. There are no problems.
No problems. Neurologist said everything is fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Right.
Neurologist told us that ki agar aapke bacche ko ichha hogi, then only she will do this thing.
तो आपका ये एक ही बच्चा है आप दोनों की जो वेडिंग हुई मैरिज हुई वो फैमिली के अंदर हुई है या कुछ ऐसा लगता है कि फैमिली के अंदर के जेनेटिक कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन कुछ आया है
नो मैम वो भी टेस्ट कराया जेनेटिक टेस्ट भी कराया उससे भी कोई ये नहीं
ओके मसल डिस्ट्रॉफी का टेस्ट हुआ है
नहीं मैम
ओके डू अ टेस्ट फॉर मसल डिस्ट्रॉफी ऑल्सो गो टू योर न्यूरोलॉजिस्ट जहाँ भी है आप वहां पर न्यूरोलॉजिस्ट से मसल डिस्ट्रॉफी का टेस्ट करने को भी बोलिएगा
ओके मैम
डिफरेंट फॉर्म्स ऑफ मसल डिस्ट्रॉफी होता है दे डू अ प्रोटीन एनालिसिस ऑफ अ मसल मसल बायोप्सी करके मोस्ट लाइकली वो हो सकता है
ओके मैम ओके मैम प्रॉब्लम
अभी क्या हो रहा है
अभी मैम मेरी एक छोटी मतलब मेरी एक बेबी हुई है वो 1 ईयर की है उसे देखकर वो बहुत जल्दी कैच कर रही है थिंग्स को उसे देखकर उसके एक्टिविटीज को देखकर मेरी बड़ी बेटी बहुत कुछ सीख रही है
राइट आप एक अच्छे न्यूरोलॉजिस्ट से कंसल्ट करके दोबारा मे बी डू अ स्टडी ऑफ हर एंड देन आई एम ऑलवेज देयर लाइक आप मेरे से कभी भी बात कर सकते हो
ओके मैम ओके थैंक यू मैम थैंk you very much
Dr. Anjali, just out of curiosity, since this is a very critical case where there's a 9-year-old girl unable to walk and, you know, stand without support, and she is not talking much, talking in monosyllables, like the mother said. You've been talking about early intervention in certain phases, in certain cases also. How do you see what could be the, you know, problem with this child? Was she not diagnosed properly or was she not, you know, handled properly at home to address the issues that they might have been seeing this from the early stages also?
Yeah, I think we lack a lot of this education in the parental, you know, like parenting. This education should happen when the mother is pregnant, you know, that is very important. Like I do a lot of pregnancy classes and preconception classes. Hello? Mm-hmm. Yeah. What is preconception classes? It's very important that as a parent, instead of doing your horoscope study, do a blood matching study, do a genetic study before you get married. Because most of these genes can come from parents to a child, right? There can be a faulty gene which has come in a child. That is preconception. Now, once you're pregnant, it's very important as parenting, we do a parenting tip that your child is born. This is what the child has to have. This is what child should not do and all that. The moment now when you are born, you have an infant with you. I think a weekly visit by to the hospital is not possible, I know. But at least you'll have a monthly checkup by your pediatrician. And most of the times, also do reach out to an occupational therapist, physio, and to look at early interventions. Because until unless the doctor writes in a prescription that you need to see a physio, most of the parents won't go and do it. And touching on all aspects and all regions of our country or the world, many parents are not aware that a child should be able to walk at this time or should be able to talk at this time. It's not normal that the child is not able to walk properly after these many months. You will have to intervene. You will intervene in the sense you will have to see a pediatrician, need to see a neurologist, need to see a physiotherapist and an occupational therapist, a psychologist, the team of people who deal with delayed milestone for a child. You just cannot be shying away from your problem. You know,
absolutely, Dr. Anjali, we agree to this, and that is why Moms Believe has been aggressively working towards providing these services to all the parents, special educators, caregivers, and everybody in the domain. We have specifically designed programs for early intervention occupational therapy, speech and language, parental guidance and counseling as well. And I think parents should be very, you know, forthcoming in sharing their problems and discussing. They can always reach out to Moms Believe for any kind of guidance and support. And I think you made a fair point that early that you intervene, the better the results will be.
And I think one must not shy away if your child is having an issue. Don't feel there is a social stigma attached to it. If you solve
absolutely
your child,
the child's life matters most. So, Dr. Anjali, thank you for this. And there's one more question that the lady is waiting with. She's Nanda. Please unmute her, Shiv. Nanda.
Hi, Nanda. Miss Nanda, please ask your question. You are unmute right now. Yes, ma'am, please.
Nanda, please go ahead.
Ma'am, my daughter is 6 years old and she's having delayed milestone, like delayed speech only. Nothing.
Only and you've seen a speech therapist? Have you met a speech therapist?
Usko maine join karwa rakha hai, OT therapist. But wohi due to COVID na discontinued ho gaya and kafi improvement hai. But 1 month classes li usne, usko kafi improvement hai.
तो बोलने में क्या नहीं बोल पाती है वो
मम र र क्लियर नहीं है र साउंड मतलब काफी कुछ बोलती है सारी नेम वगैरह सारा सब कुछ एक्सप्लेन करती है बट वो मैं लाइक ना अपनी एक्सप्रेशंस को वर्ड्स में कन्वर्ट नहीं कर पाती
वर्ड्स में नहीं का और ऑटिज्म का कुछ भी स्टडी किया गया है
नो
तो गिव अ टाइम कंटिन्यू विद द स्पीच थेरेपी विद हर
ओके
खेलने जाने दीजिए भागने दीजिए कूदने दीजिए
जो ने सब कुछ बंद करवा दिया कोरोना ने
नंदा क्यों बंद किया हुआ है
कोरोना आई वुड सजेस्ट वी एट मॉम्स बिलीव वी आल्सो यू नो गिव ई थेरेपीज टू किड्स एंड वी हैव बीन सर्विंग किड्स इन द एंटायर कोविड पीरियड एंड इफ यू आर विलिंग एंड यू वांट We can always be of some assistance to you and help your child.
Sure, ma'am. Thank
you. Don't have to be, you know, bothered about visiting a center or something. You can always do that. Centers are also opening up now. But if you wish, you can get e-therapies also for your child.
Okay. Thank you.
I hope we have been able to answer all your queries. In case you have any further questions, please do raise your hand or drop your question in the chat box. We'll be able to answer them because we're already, running short of time. We have crossed the time limit that we had for the session. Any questions, please raise your hands or drop your questions in the chat box. I guess there are no more questions, Dr. Anjali. Questions have ended and I would like to wrap the session. It was very nice having you here for the webinar. And you were able to help people with your guidance and expertise. And we hope to have you soon again.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Priya. Thanks, Mom Believe. And thanks to all the participants.
Thank you so much, everyone. So this will be the wrap to the webinar. See you soon.
See you soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.